everyone. This is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's episode, Financial Management to Help Unlock Business Growth. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section, and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and thank you for hosting this webinar every week. Welcome, friends, and welcome to BusinessX Academy. This is the second series we're doing. We finished one series of 30 episodes on how to value your business, how to scale, how to find an exit, and how to invest into newer opportunities. And this series was on a business coaching, so we take about one topic every time, and today's topic is on financial management. And I would like to make it very interactive, so you can use Q&A box. This is about 30-minute odd session. We'll talk about, you know, how you can best achieve your financial management, how it is so important, especially for early stage and mid-sized companies. BusinessX is a platform of Franchise India, where we work with companies to help them to scale, help them to really raise capital, and also find exit if they are looking at it. I have do another webinar, which is every Friday evening on exit planning. So that's also an interesting webinar if you want to be part of somebody who wants to really look at planning to exit the business and getting the right valuation. That also can be very helpful. And there are many other webinars we've been done. This is a 10th series, 10 episode. We've already finished. This is the 10th one. And so if you want to really revisit the 9 previous episodes, they're all available on our Facebook group. So that's also going to be a helpful resource for you. So let's get started and let's understand financial management. And financial management, I'll probably go and cover about 7 different topics, which are part of financial management. But starting is that it's a certain amount of what I call a combination of a knowledge and discipline. How you build, continue to build knowledge from a lot of data which comes from your enterprise and a company, and how you continue to put a discipline on every single function of your business. It's also very important when you're doing financial management for your organization, especially for smaller businesses. And it's very important in the early days you put some kind of a strong discipline in the structure, and that would help you later when you start scaling up businesses. And we've seen a lot of times when you go from a relatively early background to go and scale, issue is not about getting more customers. You're not about getting driving your top line. Always issue comes around how do you are financially designed as an organization, and sometimes you run out of gas. So very important aspect, and especially these days, is how do you manage your cash flows? How are you managing your cash flows? How you're tracking your business performance on a regular basis? That's very, very important. What are your short-term and long-term plans, which are very important, how you want to execute that, and what it takes to really define those plans? We'll talk about that. And also maximizing opportunities. Sometimes opportunities strike you and has a very short window to do that, which may mean that it will suddenly require a lot of capital for you to go out and maximize that opportunity. A lot of times we miss an opportunity because we don't have that kind of a bandwidth, both in terms of resources and our financial bandwidth, that we will be able to do that. And in the current times, especially with the times which we are all living in, it's a very changing times. You know, it's a very every day you have a different circumstance to do that. Like, for example, one of the business I'm advising, the last 2 months when the lockdown happened, they had absolutely crashed the sales. But we clearly knew that there was a very strong pent-up demand, a very pent-up, big pent-up demand, which would start from 1st of June. And that company, we really saw in the month going and building it up. But that would mean that they were absolutely planned. The day one, the lockdown opened up, their resources were there, their finances were there, their supply chain was in order. So they were able to maximize. I know there were competition, a lot of competition was there, which were not able to manage. They were just coming up, and a lot of people really are doing that. In issues like these, you know, what happens in our current environments, you might get short windows. These are windows of opportunities. And if you're not financially well designed, you will miss these windows and you will not be able to do that. So you need to really keep up what I call a very, very strong and proactive approach. Financial management is also a combination of how do you really keep eye on your day-to-day management part. That's very important. And also on the broader strategic viewpoint, which means you have a long-term viewpoint on that, but that has to match with day-to-day management. And you see even the larger companies, and you can take a classic example of Anil Ambani Group. You see they had a very strong strategic viewpoint on businesses, which means that they had a long-term contracts, especially if you look at the businesses like Reliance Infra, Power, and so on and so forth. They were very strong long-term view on that businesses. And that's why sometimes markets reacted very well for them, but they were losing on their day-to-day management and cash flows and so on and so forth. So their burn was increasing, the cost of capital was increasing, and the businesses eventually were not able to sustain. So unless and until you create a combination of these two things, one is your day-to-day management and defining what is required, and also a little bit on long-term strategic planning. One question which I would really start with before I go on my 7 points, which are part of the financial management, is a question which is very important. Do you think yourself, and this question is for everybody, you can answer it on Q&A box if you really feel that, how you are structured as an organization today, you know, and what kind of financial skills you have in your enterprise. And that's something which is very, very important. Sometimes business owners are running their own finances and they don't have strong financial skills in the enterprise, which means that they would have a little view on the business. They would not have a very holistic view, and they would also not be able to create bigger possibilities. And that's what actually small businesses sometimes struggle, because they don't have those kind of skills. So be honest to yourself and really talk about that. Do you really have that required skills as a financial for a financial management? And if not, then you need to engage somebody. You need to engage somebody who's a specialist, maybe hire a CFO. If you don't have a good CFO, then you probably would need to have somebody as a consultant who can put some hours. And there are a lot of good financial planners which are available in the market, where you can work on a few hours with you every week to really talk about a lot of things which are required in your business. So that's a first point. That's very, very important to be very honest about, seeing that, do you have that kind of financial skills in the system before you even went out to put up a full financial management. You also have to maintain what I call reasonable transparency. Because sometimes financial management looks like it is between the CEO and the CFO of the company, and they just do their understanding and putting the viewpoint on that. But actually, no. I have realized that financial management is taking every stakeholder in the part of the decision making. Unless and until every stakeholder is involved and understands, then it will all pile up to a larger goal. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Like, for example, you have a marketing department. If the marketing department doesn't know how to really go with a very firm idea of budgeting, what do you want to really budget for it, what do you want the outcome of that, what is your cost of acquisition of customers, all that is their discipline. So unless and until we clearly have all the departments and your employees are participating into the larger financial management, it would never work. It would never work. So even from a productivity, if you want to really be very open to your employees about what is the productivity expected from them, what is the cost of people which is you can afford in the organization, what kind of a throughput you want from every sales or business development person in your organization. So you have to have what I call reasonable transparency. You cannot give everything out, because sometimes there's a lot of confidential data, but there has to be a reasonable transparency which actually aligns people to for a larger goal. And that's something which is larger companies, public companies are very good at it. So everybody can read their financial statements. They are public in nature. So they know that what their margins they're operating on, how they're going to need to improve their margins month on month. So you need to also be putting some kind of a cultural input in that business, then only your financial management will work. The second part is about your business planning, how your business planning is stacking up, how you are really designed your business. What is your, what I call short-term and long-term goals? This is very important. Very, very clearly, what is your short-term goals from your cash flows viewpoint? Short-terms are more really driven from your cash flows. What kind of cash flows you would need to really get in your business? And long-term goals are much bigger on terms of the shareholder value or dividends you want to really achieve on the business and so forth. And overall profitability, or also building a larger financial chest to make future opportunities and investment into those opportunities and so forth. And it's also part of your scaling up mindset. You know, how you really look at scaling up. Unless and until you have put your strong financial discipline, don't even venture out scaling. I see a lot of people go into scaling up without even defining and checking their financial health. And that's a dangerous situation to be in, because you are scaling up with some kind of estimates, and sometimes it gets overestimating what you can achieve in the business and doesn't work. So you need to really see your short-term goals, very clearly align that, achieve those short-term goals, try to bring in some kind of a predictability in the structure, and then go out and scale. And you need to also define very sharp objectives of your 12-month story, 24 months, and 36 months. I would say put this very clearly, 12 months, understand, see the gaps, what didn't work, how it changed, how your budgeting changed. That's all is part of a strong business planning. So now I'm telling my clients and say, you have 3 quarters, and hopefully if the third wave is not coming, then these 3 quarters are very important to really plan. But these 3 quarters are not about extensive growth. This is about sustenance. This is about sustenance and a very incremental growth. But the next 1 year, you need to start preparing for an exponential growth. If your business is good and you can really do that, so this 9 months can set the foundation for your very high growth, which you can achieve in subsequently the next financial year. So that probably would be your scale cycle. And then in the next 12 months, don't go and continue to scale, but maybe bring in some kind of a consistency, some kind of a sustenance of what you've already achieved. So always try to do a little bit of scale, sustenance, scale, sustenance. That's the way business should be done. So define your objectives, define your 12-month objective, 24-month objective, and 36-month of objective. What is your larger strategy? What are the assumptions you're taking in your business? And these assumptions have to be factfully coming from what you have done from historic data. So what is your historic data telling you how efficient your in past would be? So sometimes unrealistic answers really come from, you know, entrepreneurs I'm working with and clients I'm working with. So they give me a very different data which I can read, and they're drastically trying to change that, right? Say for a cost of acquisition for a customer was very high at particularly, and in 3 months they want to drastically change that. These things don't change that drastically. You can have a marginal or incremental improvement in every small aspect, but you need to be very, very sure what you need to do that. Also, whenever you're doing your financial management, do this very strong analysis on your capabilities and expertise. Sometimes you are predicting something much higher, but you lack your capabilities and expertise. If that is also not available in the system, it will not work. And that's why I say call the MWM, master what matters. Master what matters would mean that you need to really pinpoint and connect all the dots in your business before you even jump onto your financial plan. Third part after business planning would be to really define financing for your business, because where is the fund going to come for, how much you can do from internal accruals, which means that you have a predictability of next 6 months or 12 months on terms of what kind of monies would come within the business, which means from internal accruals, and what you would have to raise. This is very, very important aspect of your entirety. And most of the times, if you're not really designed to understand what kind of financing is required for your business, you will never be able to achieve your business plan, which you predicted. So it's very important. So to really keep the eye on how you would really design financing. And sometimes you're too late to define that. You're too late because if, say, your business needed something in the Q4, you should be working right now, because you need at least 2 quarters to really bring that kind of financing. It can be through debt or an equity, but you need at least 2 quarters to do that planning. Then only you are having, or you would probably have to have a plan B if you are not able to get that piece. So it's very important that you really define what kind of financing, at least in the next 18 months to 2 years, which is 24 months, your business would need and where it is going to come from. And don't overestimate sometimes your internal accruals. This is also another problem. A lot of times we get into a scale journey, we start growing the business, and we overestimate that we will be able to do our internal accruals would support that. And I've seen a lot of people, especially in this COVID period, a lot of good companies have collapsed because they were overestimating their own performances. And because of the performances and everything was shut, they were not into it. There's one restaurant operator which I'm trying to advise and trying to restructure their business model. They have about 9 restaurants which are almost finished to start, and but they have run out of cash. They don't have cash. They don't have abilities to finance that business. So they have a risk of losing all that capex which has been designed, put in that business, going into drain. And they have also built some liabilities because not paid renters and a lot of other issues. So it's a difficult situation to address that. And so at evaluation, we are taking a big haircut to do that. So how you going to be financing your business is also very, very important. It's also a combination of what I call a flexibility and control. How you bring financial flexibility, how you are able to really change few things which is required, and how you can really accommodate maybe an external investor or a financier in your business that would bring in some kind of a financial flexibility. But you need to have a very strong business control. You cannot lose that control on that, because especially when you are raising, it becomes even more important that you put a very strong business controls on it, because sometimes it's expensive. It's expensive to raise capital. Once you get that capital, if you don't keep the business control in right sense, it can be even more disastrous. Losing your own money is one thing. Losing somebody else's money can be even more stressful and painful when you do that. So you have to very clearly understand what is your financial strength telling you. What is your current books are telling you? How much leverage you can hold on your books? What has been the past track record for you on a performance to handle that entire thing? This would bring another important question. If say you're going on debt and you're taking some kind of debt, then you need to really see that is financial cost your business can afford? Not on a short-term, but a long-term basis. Can your business afford that kind of cost? And this is also another problem, especially for a lot of mid-sized manufacturing companies. I've really seen them operate in such a thin margin. And it's a very competitive world. They're competing with their competition on a very, very small margin. And they take a lot of debt on that. If you really see these a lot of export-oriented organizations, which were working on a very small margins. While export would technically mean that you can work on a larger arbitrage and bigger margin, because there are so many players in the market and doing the same kind of job work in different developing countries. So your margins have become very small and you're only doing the job work margins. And then you pile up a lot of debt on the business and your cost of capital would never justify. And so it keep rising. And you're trying to justify by your sales volumes and so on and so forth. But eventually at one time, it'll give up. And if any decline would happen, I've also seen companies sometimes, keep jacking up, even public listed companies keep jacking up their shareholder value and leverage that value over debt component. And as they would reduce their, equity value out there, the bankers would come after you because they want more collaterals to support your business. And that's where it starts a downturn. A lot of companies have actually gone down the drain just because of this mismatch of their cash flows. They were overprotecting their capabilities to bring that, and that didn't have. So also that brings another point. What is your financial risk? How much you're putting on the block as a risk? What is your personal finances requirement? And this is another big problem. Whenever you're doing, you are two things which are running in same time. One is your business. What patience is your business showing? And what patience you as an individual are showing? That's also very important. What is your personal finances telling you? What kind of requirements you have? And sometimes your requirements are immediate, and then you start pulling up from your business, and business is not ready to give that dividends to business owners. And I've also seen a lot of startups have failed because the personal finances of promoters or founders actually pushed them to sunk a lot of money out of their startups, and the startups were not able to sustain. That's not part of a good financial health also. So very importantly, put a very holistic business strategy for your business, and then only you will be able to do that. That brings me to the fourth point, which is very important point, is whenever you're doing a financial management, financial discipline is extremely, extremely important. Wherever you're raising money for, even from your internal accruals it is coming from, or an external sources it is coming from, wherever it is designed to go, it should go there. That's extremely important. Otherwise, if you change things, at least the external investors don't like it. And that's why I sometimes feel that keeping a very strong financial discipline is very, very important. There is a good saying that says, capital is part of your wealth, which should be directed well so that it can create further wealth, which means that it's very important. Where are you putting the money? Where are you putting money would be very, very important, and how you really design that. So sometimes you put monies into things which cannot create what I call the right kind of impact for your business. And I've run a business particularly. We were an old school marketing company and we used to use a lot of print. And there was a particular time in 2015-16, I don't know how many of you have seen that, but Franchise India was running these full page ads in Times of India, HT, and so on and so forth. We were on this ride of building the brand equity and so on and so forth. And later we realized that we were spending about 35% of our total turnover in actually in marketing, which means that 35% was just pure marketing. It's not even cost of acquisition of customer. It was pure marketing. And then you had cost of sales and so on and so forth. So if you really see, while we were creating a huge amount of brand equity, but that was not converting completely into sales because it is a consulting company. It's like a KPMG and EY goes every day and puts full page ad. While you can tell people that you exist, but it not make any sense to that. So sometimes you have to be very rational in your financial discipline that you're not going out. And this is one of the areas which I like sometimes people who start with a business plan and they stick to business plan. They stick to business plan. Sometimes it would be difficulty, but they would not change unless and until there are strong, compelling reasons to change that. Then we come to fifth point, which is what I call the financial control. How do you really bring a strong financial control? That's very, very important. And this is where the business owner can go wrong because business owner is very clearly linked on two things. He's always looking on the sales, how my sales is growing, numbers, which is in revenue and sales coming in the company, and also his cost structures. So he was always trying to control the cost and he's doing that. These are very broad indicators. These are very easy indicators. You don't have to really do that. But there is much more deeper into that, and which I call budgeting. Again, there is a good saying, it says budget is telling where your money is going or where your money should go, instead of wondering where it is gone, right? So that's very important. If you don't write a good budget about your business, even every single month, you have to have an annual budget, and then you have to have a very strong monthly budget. It should define very clearly your growth cycle, demand generation cycle, how your demand is generating, and what is every single smallest thing which is happening in your business. And sometimes it looks very easy for an entrepreneur to be in control of his finances because he's almost looking at everything, but it's not true. You need to have a specialist. You need to have a specialist who can draw this whole thing in a very systematic way. And this might change. This might be changed. Like for example, in last 1 year, we've been working with many companies and I felt, and I've worked this strategy very well. I looked at their budgeting structure, and in the conventional time, there was a cost of occupancy, which means that you are paying renters, you have premises on lease and so on and so forth. And there are other things were happening. So like I was advising one company which has both businesses, they have retail business and they have online business. And when this all things going on, the retail business was not doing well, right? And obviously retail was not predictable. So I actually told them to close a lot of stores and use that money in building their online business and shift that business model. So sometimes you need to shift your one head of a PL, which is taking a lot of load, and restructure that. It might not be critical at this moment and you cannot drop your margins. So you might have to shift that in your budgeting and move it to some other head, which is more in demand at that stage. Say, for example, sometimes your cost of talent has to go higher because you're now not getting talent at that level, which means that if your cost of talent is going high, where are you moving that extra percentage in the cost of talent from which part? What you can reduce? Can you reduce your marketing? Can you reduce something else? Can you reduce? So you need to be creative in your design of a structure that how you can move something from there. And also, when you are working on your budgeting, you need to really also accommodate a lot of deviations which can happen. Deviations can happen from delay in your payments. It can be done. It can also, a deviation can come that you need to maybe do a next level of innovation of your product because the competition has suddenly come up with something which you need to also do. So there is a new development cost which can suddenly hit your business model. It can be also over reliance on something which you were thinking that it will always happen but didn't happen, which means that you are sometimes working only on few set of customer base and you are overly reliant on that, and they suddenly, for other reasons, are not available today. Like a lot of companies which were too dependent on 4 or 5 corporates. I'm advising an exit for a travel company out of Chennai, which had actually about 5 big companies. And these 5 companies were giving almost all the billing for their travel. Now, this company is absolutely stuck. Monies are stuck. They're not getting money. So there's a lot of outstanding which is available with them. They obviously have no business because people are not using any travel structures, and they are still running their cost. And the issues is, even in the marginal business which they have, if they don't continue to service that, there is a risk of losing those customers also. So they're very difficult situations one can really go at. So understand all these exceptions which can come in your business, all the deviations which are coming in the business, and how you really accommodate those in your budget. So that would give you a plan A and a plan B. That's both are very, very important. The sixth point is business improvement. Financial management, the biggest thing financial management does for you is help you to improve your business. Look at business from a different viewpoint. Look at from a distance and understand, are you overestimating or over-optimistic about your business? And if that number what you're thinking is not happening, what happens to your business? Second, looking at overall what kind of a pitfalls can come. Is a competition getting aggressive and can really put you into trouble, like what happened in some of the companies? I saw the competition was very, very aggressive and they actually eroded all the margins available in that. We've seen almost in every industry. We've seen in telecom, one competition comes in, like Reliance was always very aggressive on their pricing and structure, always eroded almost everybody's, you know, budgeting and balance sheet because they took the margins away from business. So you need to really be very clear on that. You also need to really go deeper into your, when you're doing a business improvement, you need to talk about business performance and efficiencies, what kind of efficiencies working on that. Another thing which is very, very important to keep eye on is inflation versus your margins. Inflation is a big problem, and especially for next 2 years is going to be a huge, huge problem for businesses. So you need to really keep a strong eye that inflation should not be a big problem in your business. Everything is rising, like in building construction material, look at everything which is supply is coming to you. So even if you launched a project in 2020 and 2021, you've already sold the apartments at a certain price and now inflation has hit you, everything has gone to the roof. Now you have no choice to stop the project because you have to deliver on time. Otherwise you run penalties on that and you have to pay interest to your home buyers and places like that. But otherwise, even if you finish the project on time, you probably would have to end up doing on loss. So how do you really address this situation? This is a very unique situation to be in, where you have now got a customer to deliver over 4 years and you have already committed a price and your inflation has hit. Do your contracts have that ability to revise that pricing? I mean, not in some cases you cannot, but in some cases, people would keep that capability in the contracts. They would clearly define that they can go out and not lose their margins just because their cost of input has gone up. So that's very important aspect. So keep checking your PL. Keep checking your PL. Keep your margins intact. Rather, continue to make an effort to improve your margins. And prepare for a not so great time also. If you have good margins running in the business, even if you have a bad 6 months, you will be able to sustain. And this is where the large companies, if you really see, because they work on a large margins like RIL or even organizations like Tata's and so on, so they always are capitalized. They always are capitalized because they've always kept the margins in right. And whenever the adversity happens, they rather take an opportunity time to go out and use that cash reserves to pick up newer assets and newer businesses. And now you'll see in this year, as the business would go to normalcy, you will see all these companies which are sitting a lot of cash would use this as a great M&A opportunity to acquire a lot of business. So last point, which is the seventh point, keep looking at your key indicators. Your month should start looking at these five indicators. First, growth. What is happening on your growth month on month? It's not just about your sales or profits, but it is also about average consumer spend. Has it grown? Has it declined? So a lot of smaller indicators within the growth path of your business, that has to be looked at. So first, very honestly, look at your growth. Second, assess your profitability, not with you what you are happy. Is your profitability comparative to all other companies which are available in the same space or a comparative space? So how are you doing versus industry? That's very important. Sometimes we look at a profitability, we are happy of that profitability, but you are not doing as good as the industry is doing. Others are doing much better than you are. So you need to really assess your profitability on that perspective. That's also very, very important. Third is what is your liquidity? What is your liquidity telling you? How can you last? How much gas is with you for a short term and a long term? And this is a time, I would say, this is a window to really put 9 months, not go back, rush to growth, but bring your liquidity back. Fill the tank back. That's very important because in the last 14 months, almost everybody has come down to the lowest level of the attack, right? If there were businesses were active and not getting the same kind of cash flows, they would obviously use some kind of a liquidity in the structure, or they have put liquidity in pressure. So I would say that next nine months is to bring back your liquidity in the space before you start run for a big scale-up story. Next is how much leverage is available in your books. What can you leverage on that? Don't over-leverage yourself. Never do that. It's a mistake, especially in India. Cost of capital is so high that I don't advise at all. And I've seen so much of great companies, and so unfortunate when I read about them in news and media and so on and so forth. And I knew those companies very closely. And because of my consulting business, they were good entrepreneurs, good businesses, but because of their leverage, they were not able to really do that. And the entrepreneurs became overambitious, that they were thought that they will be able to pass and sail through this cycles, and created some super ambitious plans to really deliver that. And that doesn't work. And that doesn't work even not only for businesses, but it doesn't work for nations. You know, sometimes nations can go wrong in their approach on this entire thing. And finally, the fifth point, which is the fifth indicator, is your asset maximization, which means, are you sweating out all your assets? And if you're not sweating out, either reduce those asset burn, right? Which means that if you say have 10 offices you have, and you're not running to full of capacity, you don't need that entire thing, cut down offices, cut your fixed cost down, right? So if you don't need that thing, like Cafe Coffee, they started doing it, right? But they were not able to fully do it. Before they started cutting down their stores, now they're shutting down a lot of stores. They're from 2,000 plus stores, they've come down to about 800 stores. I think they would go down further another 200, 250 stores. But this before that, they had a strategy to really optimize their places. So they were bringing other retailers inside their store, so they're able to maximize. Sometimes I have 2,000 square feet, but I don't need 2,000. Even if 1,000 I had, I can still do that. So how can I cut down? I can negotiate with my landlords, bring my space down. So you need to really see how you're doing your asset maximization. It's very, very important. So five indicators: see your growth monthly, see your profitability, not from your perspective, but from a comparative viewpoint, see your liquidity position, how much leverage you're available in your books, and finally, how your assets are maximized. So this was a short session. This was a 30-minute session. I have already done about 6 minutes over. Sonali, if you have quickly some questions for me, I will be more than happy to take that.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for another wonderful and a very insightful session for all our attendees. I'll just quickly jump on to the Q&A round. The first question that we have is, should financial management be the responsibility of the finance team or the CFO only, or is it something to be owned by everyone in the company? Which approach culture do you suggest?
Everybody in the company. Obviously, some data would always be confidential. It can never go down with everybody. That's why I said restricted transparency. So you need to have transparency, but there has to be some restrictions, which is important. Otherwise, you lose a lot of data, which becomes public. But unless and until you have participation from everybody to really understand that they are... they're responsible for the larger piece to it, and try to bring that kind of wisdom with everybody, then you see there would be a better financial management.
Right. The next question we have is it a good practice to hire an outside firm to manage our finances, or should an in-house finance team be preferred?
Depends. You know, if you are able to afford a full talent in-house, then it's fine. But if you don't need that full house, full-time talent, which is a senior CFO, then maybe you need 8 hours or 10 hours of that financial piece, then maybe outsource. And I would say for younger companies, outsource. Don't have somebody sitting in your on cost. Sometimes it is need, because if you raised money, then your investors would like to see a CFO within the organization to put some kind of financial discipline.
Right. The next question we have is, do you help in creating financial projections as well in order to be prepared to reach out to investors?
Yeah, that we do that. Absolutely. We are specialists in Business X to really build your information memorandum to define your projection and then represent you to raise future capital.
The next question we have is, my turnover is very good, but not able to achieve a satisfactory gross profit. My business is only about 1 year old. Is that fine to have such a condition in the start?
So, you know, this happens with almost every early stage businesses. Your business starts moving up, but your margins are not intact because you don't have economies of scale and your cost of acquisition is very high. Like a lot of these D2C companies, direct to consumer companies, they get very quickly on top sales, which means that they would get into 15, 20, 30 crores of revenue because they're digital first. They put in Amazon or other places, they get caught of sales, but they don't not manufacturers. They're actually buying from somebody. The cost of manufacturing and the margins the manufacturers would keep, it takes away everything from them. And then they're running discounts here and they're pushing the platforms up. So there is no way you would make money, right? Because you're not an integrated operator. You're just a trader with some kind of a brand. It's not a bad situation to be in because I know a lot of clever direct-to-consumer businesses have done that. They've actually gone to the same factory, buying from the same factory, tens of them. And selling at the same platform, but they have just different labels, which everybody has. So that's a given, but do a little bit of science, understand once you start acquiring your customer base, how do you really reduce your cost of acquisition, which means build loyalty, bring that customer base, entire thing. And then eventually also push backward when your volumes are growing, that your manufacturing cost is also lower down and you are able to put yourself between three or four different suppliers. So suppliers also start giving you better margin, better structure. But that's why I mean, financial management is very important. If you are able to put incremental change monthly, both in your input cost and your sales. So if you say, I've done a little bit more on my sales function, my cost of acquisition is dropped and my input cost is altering. So the arbitrage you're doing is a delta up. So you're doing both side a delta up. And that's what investors like. That's what they like, that you are in the right track.
Absolutely, sir. The last question I would like to take up is how to enforce effective and timely recovery of payments from clients. We've had a company delay payments for 6 months, severely affecting cash flows.
Yeah, everybody is doing that. So you need to, you know, both do soft collection, hard collection, legal entire thing. We've also suffered at being a service provider. We had about 3 million outstanding before this COVID hit, and 1 million is already gone into bad debt, which means that clients have shut businesses or they're not. I think it was two small businesses in that sense. So we have about still 2 million, I think. So it's a tough call, but we are doing all. We're doing soft, we're doing hard, we're doing collection agencies, we're doing everything. But it is difficult. I know it's difficult, and it also puts pressure on sometimes your vendors because you're not receiving enough, and so you don't pay that much. So it's a cycle break, and that's something which is going on in economy now. It's going on in economy. Everybody is pushing each other. So I think it all streamlined in next 6 months. 6 months would be a painful journey, and I'll be honest on that. So thank you very much. Thanks for coming and really appreciate you taking time out and hope I was able to give you some insight while this is designed for a smaller and medium enterprises, because we continue to give them knowledge. This is our community, which we need to continue to service and give our experiences. Hope you liked it. I can really add on, which you need more help. And if you want to really get some notes from me, please reach out to me. I'll put my email ID. It's gm@gauravmaurya.com. So thank you very much. And if you are looking to raise money or you're looking to invest or looking to exit, please reach out to Sonali and we'll be more than happy to do that. We have great assets also. If you want to look at running businesses to buy, that also we have available. And if you are somebody who wants to have a strong growth story and you want to really take some advice, we have all available to help you out. Thank you very much. Thanks, Sonali, for hosting this.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for a wonderful session as always. And thank you to all our attendees. We really hope you were able to add some value to your lives through this session. We'll see you next Saturday at 11 a.m. with another episode in this series of BX Academy Business Excellence Mentoring and Coaching. Until then, if you have any questions, any queries, anything you would like to know more about our services, or if you would like a recording of today's session or any of our previous sessions, please reach out to me and I'll be very happy to help you. Thank you so much.